Lights out, everybody.
This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland
for Halloween 2018 and the spirits ride. The veil between the worlds grows thin. Tonight we're going to be talking about phantom messages from the beyond, from the dead, from E.T., one of the strangest shows we have ever aired. And for you subscribers, listen to my chilling story, Mr. and Mrs. Werewolf in the subscriber area. Maybe you have had the experience of a phantom message coming in over the phone, over your computer, somewhere else in your life. Maybe you haven't, but a lot of people have. Phantom Messages is a tour de force of the extraordinary realm of paranormal communication experiences, says Dr. Andrew Nichols, the director of the American Institute of Parapsychology. A number of frequent Dreamland guests would agree with that. Most notably, Nick Redfern, who says, when your cell phone rings out, the caller may not be human. And Colin Andrews says, phantom messages is the most appropriate title I could have imagined for this fascinating book. Well, I think it's fascinating, too. Brandon Masullo, who did a great Dreamland, also loved the book. Bill Hall and Jimmy Petanito. Jimmy goes by the name Mr. Haunted. We'll ask him why in a few minutes. Have compiled a book of absolutely fascinating messages from basically phone calls, letters, emails, and texts from the unknown. Guys, welcome to Dreamland.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for having us.
I guess the first thing to do is to ask the two of you what brought you together in the first place. And then we're going to get into why you're interested in this subject at all. Because, I mean, let's face it, there aren't too many books about this out there. This is one of the few I've ever seen. So first, Bill, what brought you and together with Jimmy?
Well, we were friends already for a few years. And Jimmy called me out of the blue. Because he wanted to, he was looking into writing a book, and we got to talking, and next thing you know it, we're fascinated by phone calls from the dead and that research, as I'm sure a lot of us have that book on the shelf from the 70s, but we wanted to take that and broaden it, and that was by the end of the phone call, that's what we had.
So... yeah, I read Phone Calls from the Dead years ago, and it was absolutely fascinating. For once, it's something in my life I don't ever recall experiencing. I want to know if either of you have ever had a direct experience of this phenomenon at any level, a text, a call, et cetera, and so forth.
Jimmy, I don't think I've ever gotten any personally.
No, so neither of you have.
Well, Jimmy was involved in a case with phantom messages, a cable box.
How did that work?
Wow. You want to get into that? I'll tell you the whole story.
Yeah, sure. That's what we're here for. Great.
Okay. It was around 9 or 10 o'clock at night. I'm sorry, wrong story. This family was watching old reruns of Seinfeld. It was at night, I think 9, 10, 11 o'clock at night or something. And their cable box started changing stations randomly. And this is the old cable box when it only went from like channel 0 to 72, I think. And I was just going through the channels, random channels, and they figure, okay, there's something wrong with the cable tonight. So the next day, the same thing starts happening about the same time. And they're their cousin that lives in Florida committed suicide a week before. So they have a 14-year-old son that said, maybe it's cousin, whoever, trying to communicate with us. So the thing starts frantically switching stations now. And they think they're onto something. So the mother suggests, let's say that channel 1 is A and channel 26 is Z. So it immediately went to 25, 5, then 19. And using that little code that spells yes, the 25th letter of the alphabet, and so on. So they figured they're talking to somebody now. They were asking questions for the next hour, and then they'd write down the channels it goes to and then decipher the answers later. And it told the story about how this man named Joseph Dana was murdered in their apartment, and his body was never found. They buried him down the street, his social security number, all details about this guy. So the father called the police department the next day, worried that there's he felt it was a soul in need. And the police department came, two officers. The cable box gave the police officers' children's names, I think their home phone numbers. They didn't know what to think. They called their sergeant over, who's a non-believer totally. And, even though it was still working for him, he said it was a 14-year-old kid with a remote control under a blanket or something. So they would have this cable box. They would have Joe parties where they'd have neighbors come over. And when you walk into the room, the cable box would flash your age. If you're 37, it would go to channel 37. When you leave, it would flash three times your age. They think it was saying goodbye. So this went on for weeks. And the police department did they followed up on the story. And there was no man that ever existed with that social security number. There was no missing persons that matched any of that information. So they figured they weren't talking to something good or who they thought they were talking to. That's how that started.
So, by the way, I misspoke myself earlier when I said I'd never had an experience like this. I had a doozy back in the 70s, which I'll just briefly relate. I was at home with my wife, Ann, in New York at our old apartment house on 347 West 55th Street in Manhattan. And we had a Fisher amplifier, not a receiver, but an amp. And we had been listening to records, but we'd stopped. And the amp was still on silently when suddenly a voice started talking through it. And we were flabbergasted because it had no microphone. It had – there was nothing – it didn't connect to anything. And the voice actually conversed with me for a few seconds. And finally, I asked him, I said, "Who are you?" And he didn't say anything. It was a man, young male voice. And then it said, "I know something else about you." And then there was silence. And we were there saying, "What? What?" Never another word. We never heard another thing.
Oh, yeah. We have a speaker story. We have a couple speaker stories.
Okay, but, go ahead.
Yeah. Well, one, we were trying to get messages that were unexpected, not someone investigating a haunted house, getting an EVP. We want some more unexpected text messages or phone calls or emails, that type of thing. But there was one story that we really liked that we wanted to keep in. And it was a family that I think the son was, 18, 19, Bill? And he was learning how to play bass guitar. He was just a starter. He wasn't so good yet. And he would play the beginning notes to Crazy Train by Ozzy Osbourne over and over again, trying to get it right. So he unexpectedly passed away. And the family felt his presence around his bedroom a lot. They had his stuff still in his room, but kind of packed in the corner. And the family said, we think he's trying to communicate. So they left the tape recorder in his in the hallway there near his bedroom, and they went away for an hour or so. And when they came back, they were listening to the the playback, and they didn't hear anything until they heard the bass guitar playing the beginning notes to that song, which the thing was unplugged. There was, you know, there was no power going to the amp. There was no guitar plugged in, just this stuff piled in a corner.
So there's just no explanation for it.
Unless they're lying, I can't think of one.
Yeah, well, that's always the case, isn't it? It basically, right. And of course, yeah. The skeptics always say, well, they are lying. But it's not true, usually. People don't just decide to lie about stuff like that. At least not in my experience.
Yeah, you don't get anything out of it. And what we found, I mean, in our cases, it was, I think it was 71% of all the cases had other witnesses. And many were on voicemail, for example. So, I mean, you can't say, oh, you're hallucinating, or you can say there was something electronic, but then what about the information that nobody would have a way of knowing, or what, you know, there's other things coupled with that that makes it beyond explanation, even if you can argue that technologically something was off. If something involves a prediction or something like that, well, now, you know, you can't explain that part. So, but yeah, even the electronics, we had to weed out, you know, the obvious kind of stuff. But when you have multiple things, or like you say, when you're actually having a conversation back and forth, you know, we're dealing with something a little bit different than just catching a noise somewhere, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Well, let's talk about, in a few minutes, we're going to talk about some of the really remarkable cases in phantom messages. But before we leave the air, I just want to point out we're dealing with two different websites this time. MrHaunted.com, that's Jimmy's website. You can click through from there to his Friday night 8 p.m. EST show, The Haunted Chronicles, and HallOfTheParanormal.com, Bill Hall's site, where you can get a special offer on phantom messages with some special surprises. You can check it out right on the site. And, of course, it's also available on Amazon. So, and it's a fun book. I really have had a lot of fun with it. Okay, we're going to be right back, Free Dreamlanders.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
We're talking to Bill Hall, Jimmy Petinito, Mr. Haunted, their book, Phantom Messages, chilling phone calls, letters, emails, and texts from unknown realms. Now, you know, it's so packed with stories. The book, it's really absolutely, I mean, you really did a wonderful job of putting
oh,
this
together. Oh, thank you.
Oh, yeah, of putting this together. I just want to kind of pick along here. Some of the time slips fascinated me because we've had Starfire Tor on the show many times, and my wife Ann and I have actually experienced physical time slips that were documented. So I want to talk about some of the time slip stories, like the call from the future that predicted 911. It's a very chilling story.
Bill, you're the expert at that one. Go ahead.
Yes. And even in titling that one, we had trouble because, whenever you're talking about just the very nature of a time slip, you never quite know if it's a prediction or, of course, something, looking back in time. But for us, it was a future prediction. This happened in 2001, of course, David Fritz. It was about a month before 9/11. And he was at work, and David got a call on his cell phone, and it went right to voicemail. And so he, checks to see who calls, and, the number and the time, but there was no return number or time. So he listens to the message. And this is probably, it's common, but you know it. And that is when you hear something and you instinctively and instantly know that it's something very different, very weird, out of place. And he got this really bad feeling of dread. He had a real hard time even trying to put it in words for us. He felt sick instantly. There was no voice, a lot of wind, and the sound of metal banging together, like in the background. And he could hear a crowd of people screaming. Now, if I got that as a message, it might disturb me or whatever, but I wouldn't have the kind of instant feeling that, David described to us. I mean, he's describing something that is very, very different. And he was puzzled by these calls because they were continuing every day, and they all lasted exactly 3 minutes. And so he had his girlfriend at the time and three of his close friends. He wanted to play them the message. He didn't tell them what he, thought about it or what the message was. He just said, go ahead and, listen to this message I got. And everyone that was listening to it felt the same way. One friend actually couldn't even stay in the room. She couldn't bear to listen to the entire message. I mean, it had that kind of instant effect. So David ends up getting rid of his cell phone. He gets a new phone and a new carrier. The calls finally stop, and now we're at the morning of, when the towers fell. It's about an hour before, and he gets one call. 3-minute call, goes straight to voicemail, the same message now on his new phone. And then, of course, 9/11 happens. And he gets that chilling connection of the calls he's been getting. And, of course, wonders, was I really hearing a disaster yet to happen? He's honest about it. He says, I don't know. They may have nothing to do with each other, but it really felt just too real.
And the important part about that is, Bill. That the phone calls stopped after that. The phone call stopped after 9/11.
Right. Yeah, right. Never got another one. Yeah.
Which is so chilling because it implies that somebody out there knows, but why did one guy get a phone call that he could do nothing about? That's what's so frustrating. What's like that happened to me? I mean, I know something else about you, and then it ends.
Right, right. And that is a common question that we all ask. In thinking about it and just chatting about this stuff, with the time slips, when you hear an event, I wonder if there's even a quote-unquote agent behind it. In other words, maybe it's not somebody singling somebody out. Maybe it has no, in other words, agenda or anything. Maybe it's just the phone picked up this happening. You know what I mean? I'm not saying that I know that that's what it is. I'm just saying that's another possibility, that maybe it is without an agent, you know, that, or without a purpose. It would just happen to be this horrific event, you know, bleeding through, if you will. But, you know, who knows?
Sort of bleeding through as if it's so powerful that it kind of transcends time.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Well, that was put nicer than I was going to say it. No, that was good.
And folks, if you want to learn more about our time slips, go to unknowncountry.com, click on the search engine, and just put in time slips, and you'll see all kinds of stuff about time slips, including the shows with Starfire Tour and so on and so forth. And it's something, frankly, I would not have believed was possible unless it, except it happened to me and to my wife, and I literally saw it happen to her. So they are possible. Now, let's move on to, we're going to fly by on a magic carpet to Germany right now, and we're going back into the past and into the future at the same time, because this happened in 1995. This is called Computer and Television Contact from Another Time. But before we go there, free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a very brief break.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when? Well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a three-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles. For music that will move your heart and set your spirit soaring, visit www.raylynch.com.
We're talking to Bill Hall and Jimmy Pettinito, Mr. Haunted, their book, Phantom Messages. Okay, so let's go ahead and go on with what happened back to Adolf Holmes in Germany in 1995.
Jimmy, you want me to do this or you want to take it?
Yes, you can take this one.
Okay, this is one of most of the cases in the book are new. This is a famous one back in 1995 with Adolf Holmes, and he was, as they called it, I guess another term really for the EVP research, and it also believed in the phantom messages as ITC, instrumental transcommunication. And he was an investigator in that, Adolf Holmes. And he had a phone monitoring company for his experiment. And he was receiving these bizarre phone calls. Over a period of just a few months, he received about four weird phone calls that weren't shown or picked up by the monitoring service. In other words, they weren't reported, you know, as ever being made. So he reported, received these messages. Also, he started receiving messages on his computer screen,
from a deceased colleague named Frederick Jurgensen. He was a Swedish filmmaker and one of the pioneers of EVP. And Holmes took his video camera and filmed the screen that had all the German writing on it. We actually put that that view in the book.
Yeah, message, and also a picture of the guy that showed up on the TV that looks just like his actual photograph.
Yeah. It's really a bizarre case because we have the phone calls, and then aside from the phone calls, then we have the TV with this writing showing up on it. He says that it's him from Sweden. He's making contact. And he says he gave his name as Friedel, which was a pet name that family and friends used to call him. And the message was said, dear humans, as is known to you, we are in a position to enter into your structure at choice. I send you repeatedly a projection of myself, but with your appearance, the appearance known to you, the time indication on the video camera is not correct for you. The projection is the quanta of no space-time since 17.1.1991. So, you know, he gets this crazy message. And he says, each one of your and our thoughts has its own electromagnetic reality, which does not get lost outside of the time structure. And it goes on, and it talks about it mentions an important theory that originally was used in one way, which wouldn't apply, and then the second way really hits on kind of the holographic theory of consciousness. And the TV turned itself on not only with that message, but then he also received a photo of Frederick on there. And he had many messages over the course of time from this person via many different, modalities. So that is one thing we found. It didn't matter whether it was, cell phone, email, landline, letter, writing on the floor, you name it. Phantom messages, have been going on in a diverse way for who knows, maybe since the beginning of time.
Because if you look back across history, you can find, I'm sure, instances of ghostly voices and so forth before there were any electronic devices and phones. But it seems to me that the rise of electronics has been accompanied by EVP, electronic voice phenomena, and people who work with EVP, and also lots and lots of electronic phenomena associated with ghostly voices, like what happened to me. Now, one of them that really blew my mind, and it's so horrifying, folks. I want to warn you, this is one about 35 phone calls from the cell phone of a man who was dead in a train wreck in Van Nuys, California, 2008. Can you tell us that story, guys?
That's yours too, Bill. Go ahead.
That's mine too?
Yeah,
they might get tired of hearing my voice. this was a very, very big story, and it was well investigated because it became public, of course, due to the nature of the Metrolink crash that happened in 2008 in California, San Fernando Valley. It was a commuter train going 83 miles an hour, and it hits a freight train. It became known as the Chatsworth crash. 135 people were injured, 25 dead. And the way it happened was the engineer was busy texting and failed to yield to a red signal. So the train ended up on the other track facing off to the freight train that was coming in the other direction. Charles Peck, the subject of this case, he was a 49-year-old customer service guy for Delta, and he went to Los Angeles for a job interview at an airport because he wanted to be close to his fiance. They were waiting to live in the same state before they got married. So that's what they were doing. So Andrea was actually on her way along with Charles's parents and brothers and sisters. Andrea was on her way to pick him up from the train station, and they heard the news of the crash on the radio. And of course they were quite concerned. And of course the search for bodies goes on. It took 12 hours to find Charles's body. But his cell phone made call after call, only to family and loved ones. So, you know how your phone has, all sorts of people, on it, you know, your hairdresser or whatever, you know, the vet, you know, Lowe's or Home Depot, whatever. But the only calls, 35 calls in all that went, throughout the night, all went only to a loved one, his son, his brother, stepmother, sister, you know, children, friends. Those were the only people who the cell phone called. It didn't call any of the other random numbers. They did try to, you know, they answered the call. They heard static. And they tried calling back, but it went straight to voicemail. They thought, of course, he was trapped, you know, and trying to call for help. But and so they told the authorities, they traced the cell phone, and they found it in the first car, and that's where they found Charles's body. They did not find the cell phone, but the signal led them to the first car, and they found Charles's body about an hour after the call stopped. And he had died. He was in the very first car. He died on impact. He was even asked by authorities as they, you know, were investigating the whole thing, because they did investigate the phone calls. Even Verizon commented on it, and nobody could really, nobody can offer an explanation for why it would make those calls in that way, only to those people, you know, over the night. But the doctors, when one of the doctors was interviewed about it, he said, those amount of hours, he says, you don't understand. He would not have survived 30 seconds after the crash. So that's a, that's an interesting phantom phone call. The only thing, that those calls are missing is, you know, voices or anything. But what adds to it, besides, because somebody could say, well, technology's weird or whatever, but, the fact that all the calls were only to his closest, you know, loved ones and friends adds that extra dimension to it that makes it quite an interesting case.
Yeah, that's what I thought when I read it. It's a remarkable case. And we're going to, in the second half of the show, we're going to get into the ET phenomenon, which figures prominently in this whole thing, because ET is indeed calling home, only I don't think ET's calling home unless ET lives here. So we're going to have a fascinating journey into other aspects and also calls from the future, which happen. It's absolutely fascinating. So, Free Dreamlanders, thank you very much for being with us. If we are still on the old website, you will be able to continue listening. I hope that, for your sake. But in any case, for subscribers, we'll just keep on keeping on. We've been talking to Bill Hall and Jimmy Perenito. Their book, Phantom Messages. Jimmy is known also as Mr. Haunted. You can go to his website, MrHaunted.com, and click through to his Friday night podcast. I think you'll find it fascinating. Bill is at HallOfTheParanormal.com, and if you go there, you can click through to a special offer on Phantom Messages. Subscribers, we're going to keep on keeping on. The Afterlife Revolution is a work of love written across the bridge between the living and the dead, between me and my beloved wife, Anne. You can learn what it means to live across this bridge by reading or listening to the audiobook of The Afterlife Revolution. It's available in paperback, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook on audible.com, amazon.com, audiobooks.com, and wherever audiobooks are sold. Okay, now let's go into an area of this whole phenomenon that, of course, instantly riveted my attention, which is extraterrestrials. And there are quite a few. Let's start maybe with the phone calls interrupted by aliens. And we're going to talk about the baby who learned alien speak from a phone call. It's fascinating stuff. An entity caught on X-ray. Okay, but let's start with phone calls interrupted by aliens. Jimmy, I think you're ready to tell us that story. Am I right?
You're right.
Okay, let's go.
This one we call Phone Calls from a Spacecraft from 1952. It was by the stories by Jack Sarfati from Brooklyn, New York. And he was reading a book on computer switching circuits at home when the phone rang. And he answered it, and he heard a strange sequence of clunking mechanical sounds. And then a mechanical, metallic kind of sounding voice comes on the line. And a cold mechanical voice is the only way he could describe it. And it gave a long series of numbers that he didn't understand, and then calls me Jack and says, it's a conscious computer on board a spacecraft. This is from 1952. So it may have said it was from the future, but he couldn't be sure. However, that was the implication that he understood. Anyways, it says he was selected to be one of the 400 young receptive minds to be part of a special project that he must make the choice himself. So the voice on the phone said that I would begin to meet others I was to work with in 20 years. So he was scared, and everything inside of him saying this doesn't make sense, hang up the phone. He felt a strong jolt of electricity go up his spine to the base of his skull. And he heard himself say yes. So the voice said, good. Go out on your fire escape, and we'll send you a ship to pick you up in 10 minutes. When he hung up the phone.
Quite a bus.
Yeah, right? He ran like hell and found his friend, who is now a detective in Brooklyn. Him and a few other kids, they went back to the apartment to await the flying saucer. The saucer never came. And he was stunned. He only remembered that one phone call. And my mother said that there were frequent phone calls over a three-week period. She said I was walking around glassy-eyed, this guy. And finally, the mother picked up the phone and listened out of concern for him. And she heard the cold mechanical voice. She told it to quit bothering me. Oh, start bothering Jack and stop calling. And the call stopped. But these phone calls were instrumental in Jack becoming a physicist and a rather revolutionary one who advanced quantum research.
Yeah, Jack's no a famous physicist, in fact.
Yeah. He had no idea if these phone calls were from a spacecraft or the joke, or either way, it changed him.
He talks about it often. It was a profound, literally life-changing experience for him.
Yeah, and in the 1970s is when he became the leading member, as you probably know, with the fundamental physics group, which helped advance quantum information science, which, you know, some will say is bizarre, but he talks a lot, even currently, about consciousness and conscious robots. And, you know, so that it's almost like the whole area they were talking about on the phone, on those weird phone calls.
Right.
20 years later, he did become, you know, a member of that group, and he did advance things that went along with that, you know, with that theory. Again, some will either say he's brilliant or crackpot or whatever. Everybody's got their theories, but he certainly knows his stuff from what I could tell, and he's often known as a physicist when he speaks about his, you know, what he does. So, yeah, that's a fascinating one.
Now I'd like to go on to some others that are familiar to me. The case of Betty Andreasen. Can one of you tell us a little bit about this particular message and what happened? It appears in one of Betty's interviews with Raymond Fowler, and then I'll add my part of this story at the end. But go ahead.
Oh, great. You want me to take that one, Jimmy, or?
Of course I do.
Okay. Yeah, I was big into the alien part. That's the way he says that. But yeah, this is, of course, Betty Andreasen, the classic abduction case from, hopefully I'm saying the name right, because, you know, when you're a reader all these years, you don't always get the names right when you say it.
You're getting it exactly right. It's fine.
Oh, good. The Andreasen affair. And that then had strange phantom messages, phone calls. One time she was on the phone with Bob, who was a fellow witness and experiencer, and a strange voice interrupts their call. It was a male voice, Betty described as livid with anger. And it spoke in a foreign kind of tongue, I guess you'd say, clicking noises, as is common in these kind of cases that we class in the extraterrestrial bucket, tones and beeps heard on the line. Bob asked to hang up the call. He was experiencing some very visual flashbacks to his experience. And, you know, Raymond Fowler interviewed Betty, as you said, Whitley, and she said, you know, it was a different language. There were a lot of I's, a lot of T's, a lot of rolling sounds. It was fast, kind of like a record on fast speed. But even though it was fast, the words were very clear. That's what she said. She was getting nervous and upset and wanted to cry. It was something they said. They said, "It is done. It is finished." She also heard heavy machinery on the phone, as if something was being, you know, put together. She often described it as insect-like, and we've heard that a lot in phantom messages cases like this. I don't know if that's the sound they make or what, but that appears to be the norm there. She described it also, and this was fascinating to me, this quote, as a mad hornet or an ant gouging away at something.
Yeah.
There's
a sense of anger and fury in it, all right. All through her hypnosis, she describes the tone as in that way.
Yeah. Yeah, and she heard them before. She had radio interruptions with tones playing through speakers too. This was shortly before midnight on the same day of of that phone call interruption, that weird phone call. Her 21-year-old son James and a 17-year-old son Todd were killed in a car accident.
Yes.
Yeah. So yeah. That,
it was,
so of course. No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, it's a very dark story, and I've also done a lot of research into it. I've listened to all of Ray Fowler's
audio tapes of Betty. And while I was listening to it, one of these specific instances, but at one point she repeats what she heard in what they thought was a star language, an alien language. And interestingly enough, I recognized it immediately structurally as Gaelic, which I know a little bit of. And I went to a Gaelic scholar, and he said it was a very old form of Gaelic, the written part of which is known as Agam. And it was, the message was, children of the northern peoples, you wander in eternal darkness. No wonder they were upset. Because
wow.
That's a chilling, chilling message. And, you know, another very weird codicil to this is that Anne and I were learning French together, or more accurately, Anne was learning French, and I was learning what came in the family to be called fracture, which was not French, but I thought it was French. In any case, our French teacher was with us at the cabin in upstate New York, and he was lying on the deck sunning himself, and Anne and I were inside chatting, and he came in and he said, I didn't know the two of you spoke Gaelic. And we said, we don't. And he said, well, I've been out there for half an hour listening to you speaking in Gaelic. I could hear you clearly. And he wasn't the only person who overheard us. Oh, no, I guess he was actually the only person who overheard us speaking Gaelic. But we used to use a Gaelic greeting with each other when we would meet up after a period of time. After we were separated, we didn't even know it was Gaelic until we got someone to translate it. So there's something very strange going on here. Something about our past and who we all really are, and who these aliens so-called are, and a haunting message that we are somehow lost. I found that whole experience of Ray and Betty and listening to that material deeply, deeply haunting. But now let's go on. I'd like to bring up let's talk about Heather. Heather Wade is a dear friend. And why don't you tell us what you know? And you've talked to Heather about her story. I think it's fascinating.
Talks about you all the time. Well, this happened in summer of 2011. And Heather was having, I guess she always has problems sleeping, but this particular night she was just couldn't sleep at all, and she was trying for hours to sleep. So around 3:30 a.m., Heather started walking around her neighborhood, and a movement in the sky catches her eye, and it was a very bright light. It was like a star, but brighter. And then she felt a flash on her face. This really wasn't a phantom message. It was just a story that she told us about, and we wanted to include it in the book. So she felt a flash hit her face, and she thought maybe she was just so tired. She was just imagining things. And she kept looking at the light, and she said, maybe it's a satellite. And then the light started moving erratically. So it was going from side to side. It was doing figure eight patterns, making a circular pattern. So she said, this isn't normal. She couldn't figure out what it was. So in an instant, she started getting flashes in her head, images that she can't even explain, like technical information about propulsion, about how to travel through planets. And she had no idea where these thoughts came from. And it's not even stuff she knew. It's not like stuff she knew before and was just thinking of it. It was just information that she couldn't even understand. And she got a headache right afterwards. And she was looking around for witnesses to see if anybody else see this, what's going on here. And there was no one around. It's 3:30 in the morning. So this thing wasn't going away. It was moving around the sky, fluttering all over the place, darting around. And then it just took off at an incredible speed and disappeared. So she still couldn't figure out what it was. Still doesn't know what it was. So her headache was growing this whole time. It was an abnormal headache. And she was confused. She was drained. She walked back home. And she couldn't go back to sleep. So she started itching at her, she felt like a rough patch in the middle of her forearm. and she felt a rough patch, started scratching at it. And she said, this wasn't here before. So she kind of started gouging at it, and out came like a grain-sized object, like a piece of rice almost, with the consistency of sand. And she like put it between her finger and thumb, like, what is this thing? And now she's like imagining, you know, is this some kind of implant or something? Like, what? Why did this happen right after I witnessed this event? So she really didn't understand what was happening. And the object was so small that she was moving around in her fingers, and it fell into the carpet, which was a light carpet, and it blended in, and she couldn't find it. So she had this headache would not go away. So after she dropped that little grain of whatever it was, her headache just went away. And then she vacuumed up the area where she dropped it. She took out the vacuum bag, was trying to find it, and she couldn't find it. But she brought the bag to the dumpster and threw it away, and her headache just went away. And she still has, remember, this is 2011. So she said there's still like a little scar, a red mark where that little thing was in her arm. And like, we don't really understand what happened to her. She doesn't really understand. But some of the thoughts she got were we are trying to contact you. We're trying to contact different people to see if anyone could answer us, a lot like that Jack story we just told. And she thought to herself, like, you've got the wrong person. Thought that was like the last question.
I know, that was fun.
Yeah,
that was
think you got the wrong person, buddy.
Yeah, that's not an atypical response when this kind of thing happens, and it's right in keeping with Heather's personality as well.
I remember telling her, I said, this thing travels between galaxies to communicate with you, and you foiled them with a Hoover.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Man, yeah, she's a good lady. Let's go on now to some of the cases you've investigated. We can't pass through this without talking about the Angry House guys, which was investigated by Bill and Shane Sirios. So, Bill, why don't you first tell us a little bit about who Shane is, and then go ahead and tell us the story.
Well, Shane, he's been helping individuals and families for about 30 years. He specializes in negative entities and haunts of that sort, and we became good friends, and so we've tackled this case together. This is actually a bonus case, so it's not a phantom messages per se, but this lady, Sandy, that we met in Bridgeport, Connecticut, actually not far from the Lindley Street house, she would call and said she needed help. She would not go in this house ever again. Crazy things continue to happen. And, you know, would we check it out? So we went down there. No one was in the house. And her husband, he had died. He ended up getting cancer. They also got a lot of tumors and different things in that house. An insurance adjuster that came out to inspect the foundation, United Illuminating came too. And during those times, both those people left and were horrified with the place. She also contacted the paranormal group, and that and they said it was haunted, and that led nowhere. But there's a long list of things that happened in that house. There was you had the footsteps from soiled shoes, scratches. Sandy was mainly the target, chest and arm. Lights turning themselves on and off. Alarm clock. Wouldn't shut off no matter what Charles did. He actually, at the time, he had to cut the wires, turn it off. ADT alarm was going off, but ADT had no record of it going off. That sounds familiar, and that part is phantom message. It sounds familiar in our phantom message research. You know, door handles, jiggling, whispers, all those kinds of kind of, I don't want to say normal haunting things, but had those kinds of things happen. One of the most remarkable to us was her cousin, who was a gentle guy. He came in the house, and he had no history of violence or whatever. And only being in the house, I don't know, 5-10 minutes or whatever, he goes nuts. He gets angry and everything. He goes down the stairs. He takes a sledgehammer and smashes holes in all the walls. So they didn't know what was going on. So Shane and I went in there to the abandoned house. Oh, they also had hired a property management group to do some work on the inside of the house and stuff, and they ran out. In fact, they left a lot of good tools there. We're looking around, we're like, who left all these good tools there? They had all their stickers up, they had paperwork not finished, they just all left and never came back. So Sandy kept a long diary of this, you know, which was very helpful for us to get an idea of, you know, how it progressed and what it was about. Shane and I did not discover anything paranormal there, although, you know, as Shane pointed out, there's been nobody in the house. So that kind of a negative entity or whatever, if there was a parasite, for lack of a better term, you know, it would well be gone there with nobody in the house in this particular kind of haunt. So, you know, we weren't too terribly surprised there was nothing there, but obviously we were hoping to find something. What we did find was we checked out the EMF on the home because, of course, there's high frequencies. It really duplicates a haunting in a way. Yeah, you see the shadows and movements out of the corner of your eyes, and you know, and it's all very scientific, you know. So we went to, you know, we went there a few times, and what we found was that even though the electricity was turned off, there was still very high electromagnetic field in the house, especially in the kitchen and in the corner of the basement directly under the kitchen. So we went to measure that, and it was really off the charts. So we believe that is what caused the paranoia and the anger and those kinds of things. However, by Sandy's diary, it does seem apparent that there was something, you know, paranormal going on before. And also those high frequencies, not only do they duplicate or imitate the illusion of a haunting, they, of course, happen to be the best kind of environment for that kind of thing to happen, just as we were talking about with frequency and electromagnetic. And, you know, we all know that has something, you know, to do with it, of course. So that really was that case. Quite interesting. Part of it, you know, we believe completely not paranormal, that looks paranormal. And then other things that look paranormal that were paranormal that happened during you know, Sandy's years of, you know, suffering in that house.
So here we are with another mystery that just hangs there. Now, folks, if you've had things like this happen to you, do write Whitley@Strieber.com and let us know, and I'll send your stories on to Jimmy and Bill. I think they'd probably like to get them. Yeah, absolutely. So now we're coming up toward the end of the show, and what I'd like to do now is to ask each of you in turn to tell a story either that you're working on now or that is one of your favorites from your experiences. I'd like to start. Let's just flip it. Go ahead. We'll start with you, Bill.
Well, I'll have
I'll do a phantom message one.
Sure.
And this was at a time when I was probably more skeptical about this stuff than ever. But, you know, also extremely curious, and luckily for that. My magician friend and myself, we didn't hang out in bars. We would hang out in the graveyards, and we'd practice magic. And I remember this particular night, we were working on a way to vanish the moon, which we actually figured out. So, you know, we had our car there, and, you know, we're talking and chatting, and we say, hey, let's try to contact somebody. So we put the radio on, to where it's completely static. You know, there's no bleed through. It's just 100% white noise. And we leave it there and we go on talking because, you know, we think we're halfway intelligent. We figure let's see how long this white noise continues, because we don't want to conduct the experiment and be, you know, fooled by something that's just random odds. So, you know, we let it play for probably a good half hour. We did all, you know, we did other stuff, and then we came back to it and said, okay, you know, it's been like this, so this looks like a good station. And we went to graveyard, we went to gravestone, one of the ones that has a little, you know, a picture on it. It was a picture of a little girl named Mary. And so we were trying to communicate with her, and nothing was working. And then my buddy says, let's shout out her name and tell her to say something, you know, on the count of three. We'll just, you know, so we did that. Which was stupid because could have attracted the police. But anyhow, so we yelled it out, and just then the radio, the white noise ends, and it was a bunch of very, very, very fast talking, blah, 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 like that, and then it went right back to static. And we left it at static probably for another 20 minutes, half hour. We were blown away, and we didn't really know, you know, is this truly something? But it certainly left an impact. So that's my phantom message story.
Yeah. Okay, Mr. Haunted, you're up.
Yeah. Bill, that reminds me of my radio story. When I was a kid, I was maybe, you know, 7, 8 years old, and my mother had company over that night, and she says, Jimmy, stay up in your room. So I remember I was laying on my stomach. The lights were on. It wasn't a scary atmosphere. The lights were on. I was laying on my stomach on my bed with my knees bent upward. I was listening to a baseball game on the radio, and the radio that I had back then was like, it had two dials on it, one for volume, one for tuning. And it was about as big as a toaster. And I just remember I was listening to a baseball game, and I hear the stations start turning by themselves. So even as a kid, I said, oh, there must be something wrong with the, you know, radio. But I look over at it, and I could see the tuning knob move back and forth, changing the stations. So I panicked, and then something threw my legs down really hard on the bed. And I ran downstairs, and I said, Mom, there's a ghost in my room, and it's turning my radio dial, and it threw my legs down. And says, Jimmy, get back up in bed. There's no such thing as ghosts. So if that didn't happen, we probably wouldn't be here right now.
So
that was great.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And so it's like so many, many people I talked to on this show, you were activated, you were brought into it. And here you are still doing it all this time later. We all were. I mean, it happened to me, certainly. And gosh.
Well, you were one of, boy, it's just an honor to be speaking to you.
Oh, well, thank you. But it's also an honor to be speaking to you guys, and we've come to the end of the show as well. So I'm going to remind everyone their book is Phantom Messages. You can get it pretty much wherever books are sold. You can get it through us on Amazon, which we love you to do very much. And you can also get it from hallofthparanormal.com, where there is a special offer. And Mr. Haunted, on MrHaunted.com, you can click through and listen to Jimmy's Friday night podcast. Guys, thank you for being with us. Quite an adventure. Lots of fun.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Lots of fun. Thank you.
Okay. Well, everyone, happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween.
Okay, next up, next week we go into the month of November, so on Dreamland, and thanks always for staying with us, subscribers.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host, and I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.